This is Chandrasekhar. And regarding the pests and diseases, I think Ramu has given a brief understanding about this. One, we need to understand the behavior of the pest and the identification of the pest. Because whenever we treat something, suppose in terms of a disease or any insect bite or something, we should know which one was the causing agent. Unless that we know, the treatment would be something different, or we may not be treating it properly. So identification makes it a bit important in while doing the solution, while giving a solution to this insect pest problem. So if here you can see the American bollworm. This is seen in so many crops like cotton, tomato, sunflower, mirch, red gram. So this is a polyphagous pest. When a pest is seen in different crops, not related, because cotton and your bindi, all these are related plants. But if it is seen in across different species, like tomato is seen, you can see the red gram, and you can see the sunflower. So this is called a polyphagous pest. So the behavior of this pest has to be understood, so that once you learn the management on one crop, this can be applicable in other crops also. So this is like how it lays eggs, how it looks like, because when we go to the field, this has to be identified either in the larval stage or the adult stage, or based on the damaging symptoms. So all these things, unless we know, we may end up giving a wrong solution or wrong suggestion to the farmers. So here, if you see the American bollworm, one is the life cycle is important, the behavior, the appearance, how it appears, and when it does appear, this is also important. The second, the third one is what is.
Hello, Chindu.
Chindu.
I think he lost.
Both adult and the previous slides. Can I go to the previous slides?
Next slide.
Previous one. The tables.
This one.
Still it is showing in American bollworm. I mean, these are sucking pests. Especially when the sucking pests are there, the bugs, the aphids, the acids, the mealybugs. All these things, they come under sucking pests. In this group, both the young ones and adults, they both suck sap from the, that means both are injurious to the plant. They damage the plant. Whereas the chewing and biting, either part of the life they spend as a damaging stage. That is either the larva or the adult, they are causing the damage. So this one has to understand. Next slide, please. So
next,
yeah.
So, go on, Chandu.
Yeah, it did not change. That's a second one. Are you seeing that? Because on my screen, it is only American bollworm it is showing.
Tobacco, yeah, it's tobacco caterpillar, we are saying.
Okay. In case of tobacco caterpillar, the screen which you are seeing here, in this, if you see, both are the damaging, when the previous one, the American bollworm and the tobacco caterpillar. In this case, the behavior is, there is a bit of, because it lays eggs in groups, and it mostly feeds on the leaves. It is also seen in different crops like tomato, brinjal, then red gram, and castor, groundnut. So in various crops, sunflower, in various crops, this is also a polyphagous pest belonging to the same family. But the difference is it lays eggs in groups, and it likes mostly the leaves. And the previous one, The American bollworm, it is mostly a floral feeder. That means flowers, fruits, it feeds on, and it lays singly the eggs. So the difference is, it is easier to manage at the egg stage in case of tobacco caterpillar, because in mass you can manage, because if you because if it's egg laying behavior, it prefers to lay its eggs on big leaves like castor. It is one of the preferred plant. So when you go for castor plant along with your main crop, so it prefers that plant and lays. You can see the on the slide, you can see the damage, the pepper kind of, I mean, it eats away the entire green matter, and then you can see a papery appearance of the leaves from a distance. So it is easier to manage at that level. So these are certain things that we need to understand. And the stages, suppose in next stage it is 4 days, it spends its time and then emerges as a larva, and in larval stage it is 20 to 30 days if it spends. That means if you see an adult on the field, in the next 4 days there will be an egg laying in the field, and in 1 week the larva is going to emerge and the damage we can see. In that very young stages, the damage may not be directly visible, but as it goes or as it grows, the damage is visible, and at that time we resort to any spraying or any control measure. So we need to understand, one, the pest behavior, and in any crop that we are taking, hardly there are 4 or 5 major pests, 2 or 3 sucking pests or 2 chewing and biting. So it is not so difficult to manage any crop once we understand this kind of insects. I mean, in the insects also, there are different groups. I mean, you might be coming across so many things like the butterflies, the beetles, the these are the major things that we find outside. But in the crops, there are the moths, then the sucking insects, aphids, jacets, and mites and thrips, and mealybugs. So based on the crop that we are, if we identify how a moth looks like, or its young ones look like, or the mealybug looks like and its young one looks like. So these are the things that one need to understand. And there are certain things, next slide please. The one more thing is the feeding behavior. These are the basically the symptoms that we see. Some they make galleries on the leaves, some they...
Chandu, you are seeing a different presentation.
No?
Which slide you are seeing?
After this tobacco caterpillar?
Yeah, there is a brinjal fruit borer.
Yeah. For that only I am explaining.
Yeah. Do you want him to go to the next slide?
No. Brinjal fruit and shoot borer. So okay. The this is basically the symptoms in the internal feeders. These are the, once the brinjal goes in, when the insect goes inside the brinjal, management will be difficult, because unless the fruit becomes poisonous, the insect won't be managed. So before that, we need to manage this insect. So it is better to have the adults trapped in, and manage the egg laying be prevented, so that the making, whether it's the conventional or organic, it's very difficult to manage this brinjal fruit and shoot borer, because once they get into the stem or the fruit, it's very difficult. And the other thing is the behavior of this pest is, once it comes out of the fruit, it falls onto the soil on the ground and makes a cocoon in a loosely web material among the drop leaves and things. So the cleaning of the ground, whichever the parts, the fallen leaves or the damaged fruits, that is important, apart from catching. For this, pheromone trap would be the best method to manage this. Next slide, please. So coming to the diseases, There are various causal agents like fungus, fungi, bacteria, and virus. Each one has their own damaging symptoms, the causal organisms, and the spots, then basically the leaf spots, then rots, powdery mildew. These are some of the symptoms of the fungus, and it needs a kind of atmospheric moisture that should be present. That means the relative humidity, when it is high, the fungal diseases are likely to happen. And in case of bacterial diseases, especially in acid soils, based on the soil type and if irrigation or the drainage is a problem, then bacterial diseases are more. And similarly, for virus diseases, these are mostly transmitted by vectors like sucking pus, aphids, and white flies. These are the two major groups that transmit these viral diseases. So vector management becomes important because there is no medicine as such for this viral diseases. And one has to manage the vectors. And also there are certain things which can delay the spread, like Pongamia and the Bougainvillea's leaf extracts and the milk, raw milk spray. That prevents its spread. I mean, it slows down. So, and the other group is the nematodes, which are soil inhabitants, and they look like at once very minute ones, and only through microscope you can see that. And if the soil is good, if it is not healthy, then all these kinds of, because this is favorable for a certain group of organisms which may cause damage. So when the soil or health is maintained properly, all these things can be balanced. Next. So for field diagnosis, especially because the diseases, we can't identify them through our causal agents, we can't see them through our naked eye. Only the symptomatic identification, the diagnosis part is very important. So how the symptoms look like? I mean, I take the example of this corona in nowadays. So earlier, it is like it was sore throat, then fever, then loss of smell, and all these are the symptoms. Similarly, for malaria, there are certain symptoms. So every disease-causing agent has certain kinds of symptoms. So that are peculiar to for that particular kind of causal agent. So this one has to understand. So based on that, the further, okay, whether it's a disease caused by fungi or bacteria or a virus, that can be known. And the diseases are also like in the next slide, we can see there is, because of the abiotic stress, that is lack of nutrients or properly the nutrition is not absorbed by the plant because of some soil conditions or pH variations. So plants exhibit certain symptoms, which are similar to certain diseases, but these are not spreading type. Generally, a disease is either a spreading type or non-spreading type. So mostly the diseases caused by microorganisms are spreading nature, and nutrient deficiencies are non-spreading, and they exhibit similar to that kind of the diseases, microbial diseases kind. So how do we identify these things? Here you can see, next slide please.
This is a nutrient.
Yeah, nutrient. This one. The leaf symptoms, where the lower leaves, the upper leaves, mid leaves, or the whole plant. This one has to identify. There are certain essential nutrients which are in the plant, they behave differently. That is mobile. That means they can go from older leaves to younger leaves. And immobile. That means if they are there in the leaves, they won't go to the other parts of the leaves. That means everywhere the plant, the translocation takes place by the vessels itself. And they won't, if it is not there, it will go to the younger ones. That won't happen, that they are immobile ones. So in case of mobile ones, you can see here there are general elements like light green appearance, phosphorus, nitrogen, molybdenum, these are which are seen in the young leaves and older leaves, and in younger leaves, which are the top ones which are coming up, if you see any deficiency, yellowing or leaf tips are drying out or leaf veins getting chlorotic, so our birds turning smaller and all those things, they are because of certain nutrients which are immobile. That means the soil, the plant is not transferring to the younger parts. So this is how we can identify certain nutrients. That means in plants, phosphorus, nitrogen, and molybdenum and magnesium, these are some of the nutrients which can be translocated to the younger leaves, and so the deficiency can be seen in the older leaves, that means loyal part of the plant. And there are certain nutrients which are immobile, so the translocation wherever it is there, that is seen, and the plants, the later, the new ones which won't get the nutrients in those leaves, this nutrition deficiency is observed. So here we are also seeing without intravenal chlorosis, these are nutrients which are part of this photosynthesis and food preparations, all those things like nitrogen, then zinc, magnesium, manganese, all these things, they get expressed on the leaf surface because they are part of the chlorophyll and the food preparation won't be there in their absence. So there will be some deficiency, so the things can be expressed there. Next. So by having this understanding on the pest behavior, what is attracted to what and how this can be managed, we can use which one is the for managing. That means when we are growing a particular crop, there is a pest calendar or the crop calendar, which are the crops that are grown in particular area and which are the pests that appear appear on the crop, in what stages, suppose the seedling stage, then branching stage, or the flowering stage and fruiting stage. So in these periods, which are the major pests that are seen? So based on that, what we need to take the management measures. So some pests get attracted to the colors. So just by having a color doesn't suffice. So we need to have some kind of stickiness on that. So whether it is readily available sticky traps or the materials like grease or castor oil, which are very sticky in nature, that can be applied to the colored surface so that they can be managed. I mean, yellow is attracted with thrips, hoppers, then white flies. So these are the fruit flies. These are the some of the insects which are get attracted to yellow color, and white. White, actually, it is a combination of all colors. So generally, in while mentioning the color, it doesn't appear. But white, if you keep, this will attract the, because of the brightness, the thrips, the fleas, beetles, all these insects get attracted to this guy. And similarly, there is also a blue color, which particularly attracts aphids and jarcids or hoppers. And similarly, for pheromone traps, this is like attracting the males. So there are certain props in which, I mean, insects, they release these pheromones to attract the males. So using this nature of the insect, synthetically some pheromones are formulated, and these pheromones can be used in the field. And most of the crop pests that we are having now, these pheromone traps. And this is especially for two major groups. One is for the moths, that means whether it is a stem borer or fruit borer, like butterfly and moth, that category it comes. So for that we have, and some for certain beetles we have, and similarly for certain fruit flies we have these pheromone traps. So based on the kind of insect pest, what we want to intend to do on the field, that I think we need to plan accordingly based on the available resources. So this needs understanding, basic understanding of what is there in the, and what needs to be done for the plan before going for any pest. It's not just spraying certain things. Similarly, light, certain lights get attracted, certain insects get attracted to light, and especially the adults get attracted to light. So in the evening times, during the monsoons or during the crop period, I mean before beginning of the monsoon, you can go for these campfires, or during the crop period, one light per acre can attract whatever the adults that are there, which get attracted to this light. So that can be used, and below that the watery grave can be kept. The figures are seen here. So this kind of structures we can put in the field, and we can go for the management. Similarly, certain insects are, certain plants act as traps for certain insects. Some act as barriers, some act as like attractants, because they are also, the insects also like those plants. Suppose castor, in case of the earlier one, we have seen the castor. So if you are going at groundnut crop and the tobacco caterpillar is a menace, then while sowing groundnut itself, we can go for certain castor seeds also in the plot, so that castor plants also come up along with the groundnut. And because of its large leaf size, the insects go first to that castor crop because of the leaf size, because it lays eggs in masses. And from the distance, we can see, and we can manage the eggs, or I mean, we can manage the damaged leaves, or we can just go for a surveillance on this castor plants and see whether there any egg laying is there. So that kind of thing we can have, and similarly, we can set up pheromone traps for the so establishing a pheromone trap, then having this trap drop. So this gives the the next steps that can be taken. If adults are followed, trapped with the pheromone trap, and egg laying is seen on the trap crops, we can go for immediately some neem spray or that kind of. So this is how whatever the things we are using, that whether sticky traps or trap crops or light traps, and then the management. So this is how the management of pest management in the plot can be seen. Next, please. And when it comes to biocontrol, there are naturally occurring natural enemies. That is, certain wasps are there, then certain birds will be there. So conserving those things already that are there in the in the ecosystem. So that is important. When we spray any pesticide, all these things will be going away or died because of this pesticide poisoning. So the second thing is about external biocontrol, where we bring certain microbes like Trichoderma or the BT spray, or some insects like Trichogramma wasps, egg parasites. These are, so in case of especially coconut, which is very tall growing in nature, where you can't spray the any kind of sprays. So for that, biocontrol is the best method, because they release certain biocontrol agents like wasps, which feed on the eggs or the larva. So that goes and lays eggs on the pest, causing the damage, and that can that is being controlled. So these two are the methods we have. And first of all, to conserve the natural enemies, we should avoid spraying pesticides first. So starting from the beginning. And pest control won't begin with the appearance of the pest. It starts from the sowing, because there are some resting stages in the soil. So when we are taking plowing, so deep summer plowing, then different crops, mixed crops, because host plant interactions are there, where one attracts and one repulses, or says giving a signal saying that this is not convenient for you to lay eggs, or this is, I'm not your preferred choice. So this kind of communication happens between the host and the pest or insects. So when we go for mixed cropping, some of this pest incidence or load automatically comes down. So mixed cropping is one way, and the other methods like trap crops and sticky traps, pheromone traps, then introducing conserving natural enemies, then external biocontrol agents. So these are all some of the methods. And once we see the incidence of the pest, okay, can I go to the next slide? So this is what I said about preventing queries before occurrence of the pest. So because most of the decisions, the more than 50% of the pest management decision has to happen before the pest incidence, or from the sowing to actually pest incidence, most of the things happen. Establishing the seed treatment to the deep summer plowing, seed treatment, the mixed cropping, the trap crops, border crops, all these things. Because once the pest is there, we can't have these things at that time. So at the beginning itself, we need to have proper planning for this crop protection. And once these are insects are seen on the crop, then we need to take control measures. One is preventing the insect to going to the next stage, or repulsing it from the field, or making it not suitable to eat. If you spray some, there are different sprays in which we take up, because mostly this is a spray that we take up once as a control measure or curative measures. So for sucking insects, again, the sprays are also classified in different ways, where certain plants have the properties. Can I go to the next one? So these are like the botanicals and the microbials. So the under botanicals, I mean plant-based extracts, which are water-soluble, or to get the properties into the solution, some have to be boiled, like the tea decoctions. Because tea, if you add in normal water, it won't come. So you need to boil the properties to dissolve in the liquid. So we need to boil that. So there are certain plants, unless we heat, those properties will not be harvested into the liquid. And there are certain plants in which the properties can be readily harvested, like neem, pongamia, and chilies. These are some of the things which you can what you call mix in the water. Water extracts can be made. And there are some concoctions where we mix certain microbials, certain plants, certain various products, like urine, then milk, and all these kinds of things. So panchapatra, the sapani, in which there are different plants as well as urine and even dung in certain cases. So these are the things, classifications based on that. I mean, basically understanding the behavior of the pest and the plants which can be used. So how we can use these things. So traditionally at the village level, people, they have certain ideas on the, okay, we used to have, used to use these plants like this. So that knowledge is also can be integrated in this. And for microbials, this is the microbes like fungi or bacteria. There are certain, like we get diseases, even insects do get disease. So utilizing those microbes, when the microbes, microbials are sprayed on the plant, the insects get diseased and thus they get controlled. So in this, there are certain fermented solutions, but because the microbials are generally grown by fermentation methods. So certain things like Jeevamrit, Panchagavya, Amrit gel, then sour buttermilk, these are some of the things where we use the microbes that are there in the solutions, which can give a very good control when we spray on the plants or this, the insects. Similarly, commercially, certain things, they are isolated and multiplied and made into commercial formulations. This is BT in the name of Dipol or Delphin, this kind of commercially available. There are various other names. So BT powder, this is a bacterial powder. When insects ingest this, they get tight. And similarly, Trichoderma, this is a soil applicant. Basically, it prevents all the rots or seedlings which tend to get collapsed or toppled down when at the during the nursery stage itself. So when seed treatment is done with the Trichoderma, then this can be prevented. Or even the wilts, that can be prevented, which are with this Trichoderma. Similarly, Pseudomonas is also a bacteria, and this is also good for soil-borne diseases. And NPV, again, is a virus which causes diseases in insects. So there are, these are the options that we have, and this can be developed at the rural level. When we see local knowledge and local materials. So some of the entrepreneurs in the village, at the village level, can be trained and can be, they can produce some of these things and make readily available these products, and the farmers can utilize them. So this also gives an opportunity to have this rural bio-entrepreneurs at the village level, which can supply the needy things to the farmers readily available, so that a village level ecological pest management or the non-pesticidal management is not an individual one, but at the village level that can be promoted. Similarly, commercial products, there are also various other products like Trichoderma is also available commercially, then Pestomyces, then Pavidia patient. These are some of the microbes or fungi that are available, which are useful for the sucking pests, especially for the jarsets or the aphids. They can be sprayed, and good results can be seen. So, and some of the preparations, the botanical preparations we have was the neem seed kernel extract. So, the seeds can be collected from the neem tree, then dried in shade, and the inner kernel. If it is kernel, then 5 kilos is sufficient, and if it is the whole seed, I mean powder, that is seed powder that is we are using, then 10 to 15 kilos is necessary. So that can be put in a cloth bag, and then in 10 liters of water soaked overnight, and then sprayed in the evenings, because these are photolabile. That means photos in they can't stable during the sunlight. I mean, if hard sun is there, it easily gets deteriorated. So better to spray in the evenings, and The pests are also, most of the pests, whether it's the Helicobacter, fruit borer, Spodoptera, which is the tobacco caterpillar, they are nocturnal in habit. That means they come in the evening and sleep during the day. So evening spray, the pest also comes in the evening. So very effectiveness, you can see if it is sprayed in the evening. So most of the botanicals, we always advise to spray it in the evenings. And this is this is soaking in water. That means there are basically aqueous extracts, that means which product the plants, which we can soak in the water and spray the solution. And the second type is the decoctions. Decoction is we boil them and we spray them, mostly for the sucking insects. These decoctions work, and mostly for the chewing and biting type is aqueous extracts. They are neem or pongamia. These are very good for chewing insects. And one of the good thumb rule is like volatile compound, plants with volatile compound, that means the smell, scented plants, they can be used especially for this kind of sucking pest management, like tobacco, then eucalyptus, then vitex. These are some of the plants which have those compounds. So they can be, the decoction can be used, and the sucking pests can be managed with them. And the third one is the fermented preparations, where dung is the major source of the bacteria, whatever the microorganisms that are there, whether bacteria mostly. So in this, we use various products. The food materials, basically, whether it's a urine or it's a basin powder, that means the pulse powder, or some more like milk, then toddy, then fruits, then coconut water, all these things. So these are some of the different elements. So if it is Panchagavya, then you add some more things. And if it is Jivamrut, you add certain things. So these are some of the things that will, based on the food material that is added, the microbial variations will be there, and the rich culture we can use on the crops. And these are also useful for plant growth, disease management, and pest management. So this is a kind of all-in-one kind of thing. And the fourth one is the solvent extracts. Basically, instead of water, because certain plant chemicals, the principles that are existing in the plants, they are not readily soluble in either water or not in hot water. So we need to use either alcohol or oils, especially the mineral oils. Kerosene is used. Garlic is the best example. Even in our home remedies, if some pain is there in the ear or on the nails, we have that kind of, some oil, the garlic cloves are put in the oil and heated, and that oil is used as a cure. So similarly here, we use kerosene to get those principles of the garlic into that, and mix it with water, and this mix again used to make a suspension. We add some surfactant so that oil is mixed with the water, and then it is used. So these are the different options that we have locally that can be used to manage this insect pest. And finally, microbial solutions that I have explained about. The source of microorganisms is one. The buttermilk, which is having lactobacillus, the curd or the buttermilk, because of lactobacillus is present, or the cattle dung, which has numerous microorganisms, which are lignin, digesting and some internal plant. They go inside the plant and give the resistance to the plants, and some act as entomopathogenic, so that means they cause diseases in the insects. So, and soil, Jivamrita, we add also a fistful of soil to the preparations, so which has certain microorganisms which are useful. So all these things, they make these microbial solutions, and they will be useful in terms of growth, plant growth, then managing the diseases and pests. Then the what we add to this for the multiplication of the microbes are the, basically sugar, jaggery. Generally we add, in place of jaggery, we also use sugarcane or fruit, fermented fruit juices or honey, all these things, because all these things, they have fruits in common, sugars in common. And or else we add ghee or oil or oil cake, which are fats, or pulse floors, which have proteins. So all these things act as food material to the preparations that we are making, based on the preparation, whether it's the Panchagavya or Jivamrita. So this is how we manage things. So so that's all. I think over to Ram.